Yes, the broadcast is live. I thought usually we'll have countdown. So hello everyone, good morning, good afternoon, and good evening, depending on the time zone that you're in. Welcome to this webinar on Core Strategies to Score 750 on the GMAT. We kind of call this breaking the 700 barrier because, you know, the way we think about your GMAT preparation is that you've got to build your ability to that point where you break that 700 barrier or the 85th, 87th percentile ability, and then you refine those skills to get to that 98th percentile, which is where you get to that 750 score or so. But first things first, can you guys hear me clearly? And let me actually have YouTube on my phone as well, because I cannot see your comments here in real time. Okay, while we go. This webinar, ideally starts from the point where you know your strengths and weaknesses and essentially you're aware of which sections or subsections you need to focus on, and then how do you kind of have an idea of how to prepare for it. And then my focus in this webinar will be to make sure that you kind of, as you're learning, you focus on the important core skills as you're learning each subsection, whether it's critical reasoning, sentence correction, or number properties or so, and you build on those core skills. And with every hour of effort that you put in, you kind of improve. And one of the key elements of that improvement is strategic review, where you do that level of introspection and you improve forward. Okay, so in terms of, in the EGMAT world, how we go about helping students succeed is that we focus on building the core skills required for each subsection. So in the EGMAT world, 90% of the people don't go on to practicing questions right away. Only those with extremely high ability do that. But 90% of the students focus on building core abilities, and core abilities, the abilities that they lack. So we do a diagnostic, and then we focus on building these core skills. As you build those core skills, you know, you're doing this, you're building those core skills as you're learning concepts, and learning what we call as applying those concepts, which is what we call the process to solve questions in these subsections. So when you do this, this is where, if you do this well, you do this iteratively, you achieve what we call as that 70th percentile ability. And then you do targeted practices to achieve, go from that 70th percentile to that 90th to 95th percentile ability. And if you do that in enough subsections, you ultimately end up with a 750, 770, 780 score or so. Okay. So that's what you do in the EGMAT world. And essentially, as you go from that 70 to that 95th percentile ability, it's that strategic review. Let me erase what I wrote over here. It's the strategic review that is important for you to improve, because a lot of people get to that 60th, 65th percentile, 70th percentile ability, they don't do enough introspection, they keep on solving questions, and without that introspection, they end up making the same mistakes. Okay. All right. And think about it, this is fairly simple, but it's keeping things simple and putting in that effort that has allowed us to help many more students is the GMAT as compared to some of the other GMAT Club partners, and allowed us to deliver 3 out of 5 700 plus scores since 2021. Okay. All right, so we'll get started right away. Maneshwar, you know, good place to bring trigonometry. I don't believe you need trig when it comes to acing the GMAT. Probability and coordinate geometry, focus on the core skills that we'll talk about towards the second half of this webinar, and make sure that you build those core skills. And if you're an EGMATter, you know, you have the EGMAT courses out there. All right, so what we're going to do is, in the context of critical reasoning, we're going to focus on three core skills. The first is, and this is a core skill that's common across all subsections of quant, and in fact, even in word problems in the verb in quant, all subsections of verbal, I'm sorry, and even in quant. And this is a skill to visualize information. Now, often when we read a statement, we just read through it without imagining essentially that what that statement is saying in our own words. When we say, for example, if you read a conclusion that says, "Hey, the seawall will be able to sustain the waves generated by this tornado," you've got to imagine a tall seawall got to imagine C waves coming in and essentially hitting the wall and the wall being strong. Now, if in some scenario you had to also imagine that the question demanded that the, you know, that the wall fails, you also have to imagine that failure, and you have to really say, in what scenario will that failure happen? Could the wall break? Could the waves be high enough that it goes? So that ability to visualize every statement that you read or every critical statement, whether it's the conclusion or the answer choices, is really, really important. And as we solve a couple of CR questions in this webinar, you're going to see the application of this. Now, in the context of CR, CR arguments are about between 75 to 92 words, and these are very cogent arguments. What it means is that that essentially the author uses every word in a fairly succinct fashion to arrive at the conclusion. And building that logic, how does the author justify this conclusion, is what we call as a logical structure. So making sure that you understand that logic that the author uses to arrive at the conclusion is really important. And then in the context of assumptions, we talk about formulating a falsification question. Otherwise, this is formulating a pre-thinking question. Forget my bad writing, but this is formulating a pre-thinking question, and that's something that's really important. All right. With that, I want to just ask this question. Before we go to our first question, I want to understand if you guys understand what an assumption is. I want you to take about 10 to 15 seconds and write those answers down. What do you think is an assumption? What's the definition of an assumption? If you could write it down, very, very simple definition. What do you think or what comes to your mind when you see the word assumption? Let's get, while you're putting in your answers, let's kind of go forward. An assumption is an unstated idea that must be true for the conclusion to be valid. And the reason why I'm focusing a lot on that definition of an assumption is because when it comes to those difficult questions in CR, and especially difficult assumption questions, if you know this definition of an assumption, then essentially you can pretty much reject every incorrect answer choice and select every correct answer choice. So usually I ask you to write down very few things. This is one of those few things that I want to make sure that you write down. So an assumption is an unstated idea that must be true for the conclusion to be valid. So this has certain attributes. It's an unstated idea, which means you cannot infer this from the factual part of the argument. So this is not inferable. Okay, that's really important. The second thing is it satisfies this must be true condition, which means an assumption is required for the conclusion to be valid. Or in other words, without the presence of an assumption, there are ways to break the conclusion. Okay. Now you can see some of the answers over here. Manish would say there's an unwritten inference that points to a conclusion. An assumption is not an inference. And actually, in mathematical terms, an assumption and an inference are mutually exclusive sets. So no inference can be an assumption. And again, I think I've written an article on inference versus assumption. Now, this look very similar, but just in the context of what they are, they're mutually exclusive. Every assumption is an unstated premise. A premise is something that supports the conclusion, but every unstated premise is not an assumption. So an unstated premise is a bigger set. An assumption is a smaller part of that. So some unstated premises are assumptions. Most unstated premises are not assumptions. And we'll talk about this we'll discuss this in this particular question. Now, the way we do this question is that I'm going to give you this question, and I'm going to give you about 95 to 120 seconds to solve this. I don't want you to put your answers in the chat pod. When I ask you how many people choose choice A, choice B, choice C, choice D, then I just want you to say, write down A, B, C, D at that point. So that way we'll get some sort of an idea as to the choice that you're gravitating towards. Okay. So as I said, put your answers only when you're asked to. If you've done solving the question, type the word ready. All right. So with that, here is the question. I'm going to mute myself. Sandeep, if you can make sure that my camera is gone so that they have the entire screen to look at the question. So 95 to 120 seconds from now, depending on how many people say ready. All right, we are about that 100 second mark, and I see only one ready. If you're done solving the question, please put in ready so that we can move forward. Let's get a couple of more readies and then we'll move forward if possible. Okay, my timer says it's time. Sandeep, if you can put my video in as well, that'd be great. Perfect. Now, how many people think choice B is the correct answer? How many people in their mind chose choice B? Let's look at people who've chosen B. So we have Vahid, Prakar, and Alessandro and Bholu. Who all are here for choice C? C for cat. Okay, I guess there's no one for choice C. What about choice E? E for elephant. No one for choice E. Okay, and Nikhil is there as well as Maneshwar. Arav is also there for choice E. And then anyone for choice A. But four for B, three for E, none for C. The remaining are choices A or D, so you guys can put in your answers as well here. All right, with that, let's kind of move forward here. And while you guys are putting those answers in, and thank you for that participation. This really helps. So let's see what's going on over here. So we want to finance road repairs. And I see a couple of D's come in as well. So we want to finance road repairs. And the Highway Commission is saying, hey, let's kind of increase the toll on this highway. And the current toll is 10 cents per mile. Okay. So and then there's this guy called the Highway Commissioner. He makes the claim that, hey, as we increase the toll, the annual revenue will be that is generated will go up by at least 50%. So there's a keyword at least over here, which means the bare minimum will go up by 50%. It could go by 60, 65, 70% as well. Okay. All right. And so when you think about the conclusion by the Highway Commissioner, he's saying that the annual revenue will go up by at least 50%. It's really important to visualize this conclusion. So if last year, so let's say last year, LY, we're going to call this last year, the annual revenue was $1 million. This year, okay, annual revenue will be at least 50% higher. So at least $1.5 million. It could be $1.6 million as well, $1.7, $2 million or so, but at least 50%. Okay, that's what the conclusion is saying. Fairly simple, really simple to visualize, but it's important to visualize this over here. Now, the next question that we say is, how do we estimate annual revenue? And to really do that, we are given this, you know, the revenue is estimated on a per mile basis. So how do we estimate annual revenue? Annual revenue is estimated by, you have your toll per mile multiplied by number of toll miles. So we were earlier charging 10 cents per mile, and depending on the total number of toll miles that are traveled on that highway, we get this number, annual revenue. And this is really important. Why? Because essentially it's the increase in annual revenue that the commissioner is claiming. All right. So with that in mind, we just ask this one question, which is what we call as a falsification question. We say, okay, if my conclusion is asking me to that the annual revenue will go by at least 50%, and if I have to find an assumption, which means it has to be that unstated idea that is supposed to keep the conclusion intact, then let's kind of figure out, where's my conclusion breaking? Why? Because that's kind of where my assumption is going to be. So let's say, given the information, under what circumstances, given the facts and the argument, will the conclusion not be true? Will the conclusion break down? Now, what is my conclusion? That the annual revenue will go up by at least 50%. Okay. Now, annual revenue is computed by a toll per mile multiplied by total number of toll miles. We know this quantity, A, we know we are given that this is going to be increased by 50%, because that's given to us. So the only way in which annual revenue will not go up by at least 50% is if there is a reduction in the total number of miles traveled. So last year, let's say you had 10 million miles that were traveled on toll highways altogether. If this year that number goes down to 9.9 million or 9.8 million or even 9 million miles, then that annual revenue will not increase by 50%, right? So the only scenario is this, given the relationships over there. If that's the scenario in which my conclusion breaks down, then the assumption, which is an unstated idea that's required for the conclusion to hold true, will only be that the total number of miles driven does not decrease. So that's kind of a pre-analysis that we do even before we look at my answer choices, because it's really important for you to understand the logic that the author uses and then really say, okay, what's required if it's an assumption question for the conclusion to hold true? Why? Because that's what an assumption does. Okay. Any doubts on this so far? If you have any doubts on this, please let me know. Okay. With that, let's kind of look at choice B. Choice B was really popular. I'm still looking at the four people said choice B, and this is what I call as a sampling. Four said E and one said D given on this. So choice B says the total number of trips made on the toll highway per year will not decrease from its current number. So what it really means is that, hey, last year, if a total of 1,000 trips were taken, this is last year, then this year we will also have TY, this year we'll also have 1,000 trips. It could be more, but it will not be less. Now, my question for you is, you know, is it required? Is this must be true? Is it required that the total number of trips remain the same for the total number of miles to not go down? You know, and the answer to that is no, not really. It's not required. Why? Because even if this number goes down from 1,000 to 900, even then the total number of miles traveled could remain the same. Why? Because if the average length of the trip increases. So if earlier every trip was, let's say, 100 miles, now each trip starts to go to be 150 miles. Okay, in that case, essentially, the total number of miles traveled will not go down. So is it required? Is this a must-be-true statement? The answer is no, it is not a must-be-true statement, which is why choice B, even though it's an excellent strengthener, it's not an assumption. This is kind of very similar to when you said the definition of an assumption, it's an unstated premise. This is an unstated premise, it's just not an assumption. Every strengthener is an unstated premise, but every unstated premise is not an assumption. An assumption is a special kind of unstated premise that is required for the conclusion to be valid, and this does not satisfy that condition. For those of you who chose choice B, let me know if you have a doubt. I'll address that. Which brings us to our correct answer, which is choice E, E for elephant, which says the total distance traveled by vehicles on the toll highway will not decrease from its current level. And is that required? You know, if this is not true, then does it mean that the total number of miles traveled on toll roads will decrease? Absolutely. Why? Because if the total distance goes down, the total number of miles will go down. That's a one-to-one translation. Okay, and that's kind of what's there. Let's look at Manishwar's question. What could be a valid inference out of this question? A valid inference. First of all, you know, if you go back and categorize inference questions, let's kind of answer this question towards the end. Let me go through every answer choice, and then we'll go through this. When you look at average length of trip, all right. The average length of trip made on a toll highway will not decrease from its current level. This is actually a complementary to this. So let's say last year, the average length of trip was 50 miles. So each trip was on an average, not each trip, the average length, you kind of aggregate all the trips, divide them by number of trips, the average that you got was 50 miles. This year, let's say what this is saying is it'll stay 50 or less. So it would not go to 49 miles or 45 miles. The answer is that must be true. That's the reason that you have to ask. So is that must be true for the total distance traveled or the total number of miles traveled to remain the same? In other words, is there something that could offset that reduction in the average length of trip? Yes. What if the number of trips go up? So in that case, even if the average length of trip goes from 50 miles to 45 miles, if the number of trip goes up by, let's say, by 15% or so, that would offset the impact of this. So again, while this is an excellent strengthener, this is not an assumption. Okay. People who chose choice C, hopefully it's clear to them. Okay, which brings us to our correct choice E, which is the correct answer. Someone chose choice D as well. It says the number of drivers who consistently avoid the highway tolls by using secondary tolls will not increase from its current levels. So let's say that, you know, last year, I always use the word 100 or 1,000. They're good to easy to visualize. 1,000 drivers avoided the toll highway. Now, 1,100 drivers avoid the toll highway. What could compensate for the loss of 100 drivers? Each trip, the remaining drivers could take more trips. The remaining drivers could take longer trips. Either one would compensate for this. Okay. Again, which means this is not must be true. This is not must be true. This is not must be true. Okay. So for those of you who kind of looked at this, I want you to really make sure that you put in, you think about what did you learn from this question, what behavior or what concept are you going to apply better post this. Okay. Now, what could be the valid inference from this? So when you think about the structure of an argument, and I'm going to answer this in general in principle, let's see. I'm going to discard my annotations and put in a blank slide here. When you think about the structure of an argument has what I call as the factual part. And then you have the main conclusion. And sometimes the argument also has this other part, which I call as intermediate conclusion. Okay. Now, in an argument, anything that is a combination of these two, one and two, anything when you can combine one and two and essentially generate by combining one and two is what could be inferred. All right. The problem is these things cannot be linked to the conclusion. Why? Because an inference can only be drawn from statements that should be considered to be true. And in an argument, your conclusion is always doubtful. Okay. So, which is where, if you look at most inference questions would simply be a set of facts. There'll be fact one, fact two, fact three, fact four. There'll be statements which are a set of facts. They won't have conclusions in there. Why? Because essentially, if you have a set of if you have add a conclusion to that, then that conclusion in the context of inference does not make any sense unless you don't call it a conclusion. And which is where, so anything that you can do by combining the factual aspects of any argument is what you could infer from that argument. Okay. Hopefully that helps you, Maneshwar. And which is where I say that inference and assumptions are mutually exclusive. Why? Because in an inference, you never take the conclusion into account. In an assumption, you always take the conclusion into account. Why? Because by definition, an assumption is an unstated idea, which is required for the conclusion to be valid. So they're kind of joined at the hip. Let's move forward over here. Okay, so what was difficult about this question? I think it was, the arguments was really simple, but this was a very, very nuanced application, or I won't say nuanced, it was a very clean application of the must be true aspect. The answer choices were stated in such a way that unless and until you truly applied the concept of must be true, it would be difficult for you to get to the correct answer, and which is why I like this question a lot, because it clarifies what that must be true is. And the other thing which was there was, because this argument has four strengtheners and only one of those four strengtheners is the correct assumption, it forces you to visualize this. And what makes this question really powerful is the fact that this entire scenario that it presents is so simple. Each one of you, if you put in an effort, can visualize this over there. And so in many ways, this kind of helps me get through that point that you don't need those tens of thousands of questions to get there. It's your ability to extract and learn from every question that helps you improve, get to that 98, 99 percentile, rather than solving thousands and thousands of questions. Because in the end, what the GMAT's testing is not familiarity with the question or whether you've seen such a question, but it's testing your understanding of concepts. Okay. With that, let's kind of look at our second question. We're going to follow the same format that we followed earlier, where I'll give you 2 minutes to put in your answers. And when you're ready, you type the word ready. And then we're going to really say how many people chose choice, you know, A, B, C, D, E or so. All right. With that, let's move forward. Again, the core skills that we'll focus on are the same four skills, core skills that are there: the ability to visualize the conclusion, build that logical structure, and formulate the pre-thinking question. Same thing, the skills don't change as we go from one question type to the other. This one is a weakened question type. All right, Sandeep, if you can take my video away, and I'm going to mute myself. Okay, guys, when you're ready, type in ready. 2 minutes. All right, guys, please don't type B, C, D, or E, or A, for that matter. Please say ready when you're ready, and then we'll take a poll. All right, I have about 105 seconds that 110 seconds are done. We are in the last 10 seconds. If you guys need more time, you can really just say more time, and then I can give you another 30 seconds or so. Not a problem, Samir. Okay, another 30 seconds. Last 15. Three, two, and one. All right. So, Sandeep, if you can put me in there. Perfect. Thank you. And let me go look at my phone so that you guys, I can see your responses in real time. So, how many people think choice D is the correct answer? D for Delta. We'll first always get the stats and we'll go into the analysis. D for Delta. Then let's go into E for Elephant. Right? No, if you see D, if you say D, then say D. Put D against your name. That way it allows me to look at the stats. How many people think choice E is the correct answer? Put E against your name. If you think choice E is the correct answer. Okay, we have Maneshwar, we have Arav, Amol thinks it's D. How many people think choice B is the correct answer? Ryan thinks it's E. Okay, how many people think B for boy? We already know one person said B's. I think Samir said B. So we have Amit, Nikhil. All right, and then how many people think choice A is the correct answer or choice D is the correct answer? Well, choice C. I'm sorry. Either A or C. All right, while you do that, let's move forward. So, how many people were confused between B and E and they said, hey, both of them look interesting to me overall, if you do that? How many people are confused? Let's get that answer as well. So the question says, which of the following, if true, most seriously, and the question is kind of worded in a strange way, the force of the evidence cited, okay? And when you think about the word force of the evidence cited, what it's really talking about is the impact of the evidence, the role that it plays. Which statement weakens that impact? Okay. Now, remember this. The role of a weakened question is to reduce your belief in the conclusion. It's not necessarily there to kind of disprove the conclusion. It is to really just say, hey, now, given this new information that's there in the answer choices, I don't believe the conclusion as much as I did when I just read the argument. And that, I think, is really important for you to understand. So it's a weakened question, and you have to weaken the role or the impact that the evidence has had. Okay. Now, first of all, let's kind of talk about the conclusion. Which statement, according to you, is the main conclusion. Is it one or two or three? You guys can put your answers in right then and there. And one of the things as you're putting those answers in, I want to tell you is that when you come to a webinar and into any webinar, whether it's by us or by any other prep company, your goal should not be to really say, I'm going to get every answer right. Your goal should be to make sure that that you learn something from it, that let that webinar expose the gaps in your understanding. If you get answers right, you get them right for the right reasons. Okay, that's something that that you should be. So and the best way for you to kind of get feedback on your preparation, to get feedback on the gaps in your understanding, is by participating. So the more you participate, the more you put a stake in the ground, the more you know why you're making mistakes, where you're making mistakes. If you don't put in your answers, then you've not, taken a position. If you've not taken a position, you will always tell your brain, oh, I was thinking two, but I also had three in consideration. So if three turns out to be the right answer, then I wasn't that far off. And that would be the wrong thing to do, in my opinion. Okay, so again, participate. So which statement do you think is the main conclusion? And you can really see there are a few people who think three. There is one person who thinks one. And there are three people who think two. The correct answer here is statement two. This is what the author of this argument is really saying. What he's saying is simply talking to other people, that is participating in social interaction, is okay. You don't really need to engage in intellectual activities such as solving crossword puzzles or so. That's something which is there. And statement number three, for those of you who really say, why is statement three not the main conclusion? Because statement number three is written to support, to make statement number two more believable. So the role of three is to make two more believable. And that's something which is really important for you to know. So, but what the author wants you to take away from this entire argument is statement number two over here. Okay. So three is what we call as a premise. Okay. Question here. Any doubts, any question about this? All right. The other key piece that I want to make sure is this use of the term need to. Let's kind of go back here. The first statement says it is widely assumed that people need to engage in intellectual activities, which means it's required or an inference that you will draw from this is that if you do not engage in such intellectual activities, then you won't be able to maintain your mental sharpness as you age. Okay, so it's required. When you say someone needs to do this, this means it's required. It's a must condition. Okay, so just the argument structure over here. Statement two is the main conclusion where the author is saying, hey, you don't need to do that. As long as you're interacting with people socially, that's okay. Why is the author saying that? Because there's a study that really says that the more social contact that people report, the better their mental skills go. So it's saying, hey, there's a study which is there that says, hey, if people report social contact, their mental skills if someone has a degree 10 of social contact, their mental skills are 80. If they have degree 8, their mental skills are let's say at 60. Social contact, mental skills. If there's a degree 10, their mental skills are at 80. If there were degree 6, their mental skills maybe are at 50. So the more social, as this increases, this also increases. This essentially is what we call as a positive correlation. Okay, so that's kind of another, in English, if you were to depict a correlation, which is going in the same direction, this is how you would depict it. Okay, so with that over here, let's kind of look at our question and do our pre-thinking question. So the pre-thinking question would be, in what scenario, given the information in this conclusion, would you take in new information that will reduce the belief? What is the belief? that maintaining to maintain mental skills, social interaction is a viable alternative. Okay, so you say, hey, that what will reduce my belief in this conclusion that social interaction suffices? Okay, given the information in the argument. Okay, one thing is, if you really want to weaken it in a fairly simple fashion, you would just say, hey, what if the study was not done on the relevant population? What if it was done on younger people? For younger people, maybe it's there, but we're talking about as we grow older. So the segment that we're talking about is different. Okay. All right. The other weakener would be, what if as people age, you know, remember, the statement doesn't talk about, if you look at statement number three over here, doesn't talk about which folks is this done on. What if as people age, their ability to interact socially goes down? So it's impossible for them to do this, you know, for various reasons, because they become immobile, because it limits their ability to engage, and so on and so forth. So if that happens, then essentially your conclusion would be off. Yes, that's a condition, but if that condition is not viable as you age, then that recommendation is also not viable. Okay, then you can't really say, hey, you need not solve these puzzles, social interaction is okay, because if you can't even do social interaction as you age. Okay, what if just the very act of aging decreases your ability to do social interaction? What if, you know, yes, social interaction does increase your mental sharpness, but your ability to interact socially goes down as you age. So that, again, that's another way in which social interaction no longer remains a viable alternative. And there could be others as well, or where you say, hey, the reason why people are able to interact socially is because they could solve crossword puzzles. So solving crossword puzzles is a prerequisite to be able to do social interaction in the first place. Okay. So all of these would be good relevant weakeners or so. Okay. And essentially, if you look at weakener two and weakener three, what you're really saying is, in general, the principle's okay, but not for this segment. And that's a really, really important piece. If you think about in the context of general business as well, if you're trying to target a solution for a certain segment, and if the solution works in general for the regular population, but if it doesn't work for that particular segment, then you know that recommendation for that segment is not going to be relevant. Classic case in point is, if you say, hey, if you want to reduce the chance of heart disease, run. Why? Because running increases your heart rate at that particular point, and it clears up the arteries overall. But if you're talking about the old age, if those folks don't have strong enough legs to be able to run, then even though that's a viable solution, it doesn't work for that particular age group. Okay, so with that, let's kind of go through our choices over here. Choice A says, as people grow older, they're often advised to keep exercising their physical and mental. So again, it's just a general advice overall. And you think about, does it reduce the force of evidence cited, which is the study over there? It doesn't do anything in terms of reducing my belief in the conclusion that social interaction will suffice. You don't need to engage in those intellectual activities overall. Okay. Choice B is our correct answer. Let's kind of see what choice B is saying. Choice B is saying, many medical conditions and treatments that affect a person's mental sharpness also tend to increase that person's social isolation. So what it's saying is, hey, as your ability your mental ability reduces, or mental sharpness reduces, your ability to interact socially kind of goes down. And so essentially, if that's happening, then you won't be able to interact socially. So even though the general solution may work, because it's all because with aging, with this particular segment, you're also reducing the ability to interact socially, then that recommendation for this population will not work. Okay. So even though in general this may be true, but for this population, it's not true. Okay. Choice C is just talking about saying that, hey, many people can do both those things. Again, does it reduce my belief in the conclusion? No, it doesn't. Okay. Choice D, some people chose choice D as well. It says, hey, the study, how the study got data is from prior studies. It did not do primary research itself. Now, does it mean that the data is wrong? No, not really. Regardless of how that data is collected, as long as the data is correct, we are okay. Okay. Let's look at choice E, and choice E is a very interesting choice here. Choice E says the tasks evaluating mental sharpness for which data were compiled by the study, we're talking about the same study, which is in line number three over there, were more akin to mathematics problems than to conversation. So what it's saying is, remember, the study said people who engaged in so the study said, if people engage in social interactions, SI, then they were mentally sharp. Okay, that's what it says. And what this answer choice is saying is that how did we determine that they were mentally sharp? The tasks that we gave these people were very similar to solving mathematical problems. And what it's saying is it's kind of indicating that these people who engaged in social interactions could solve mathematical problems, which I think is excellent. In many ways, it doesn't weaken, it strengthens my belief in the conclusion. Why? Because if by social interactions, if I can keep myself sharp enough that I can solve mathematical problems, then yeah, great. That strengthens rather than weakens. So this is not a weakener in many ways. It's actually a strengthener. Okay. Remember, this is not saying that they did mathematical problems. This is really saying that they had the ability to do it. Don't we need to prove that? No, Shiva, we don't. As I said, the job of a weakener is to make sure that I reduce my belief in the conclusion. It's not to shatter the conclusion. Okay. And what is the conclusion saying? The conclusion is saying that you don't need to really go and solve puzzles. Social interaction is okay. Your goal is not to prove that apart from social interaction, there are other ways. That's not the goal. If you're saying that is the goal, then you've got to read the conclusion again. The conclusion is saying social interaction is enough. The author is, let's go back over here. Let's go back into our three statements. In each of these statements, do you see anywhere that the author is saying that if people solve crossword puzzles, their mental abilities will not be maintained? Shiva, do you see any place? No, he's not saying that, right? So this already is given to you as an alternate way to do that. What the author is saying is you don't need to do this. Remember, the first statement said you need to, but then the author is saying, however, this is your main conclusion, simply talking to other people suffices, which means that you don't need to. You don't need to. That's all what the author is saying. He's not saying prove an alternate way. Okay. All right, let's talk about point E. Won't it prove that the mathematical problem solving and not social interaction is keeping the mind sharp? Okay, let's take a very simple example here. I'm going to discard my annotations and let's add a slide. Let's add a slide here. Okay, now let me put in a text box because my handwriting is not so great. Let's do Cambria. People who did lunges. Everyone can read this statement, Maneshwar, for point E, right? Right? Everyone can read the statement. People who did lunges and squats did really well in high jumps. Now, my question to you is, that these people does this mean that these people did high jumps before that study? Does it imply that? Yes or no? Does it imply in any ways that these people did high jumps? And I'm looking on the right hand side because that's where I'm. I can see your responses. The answer is no, it doesn't imply that, right? All it's saying is that doing lunges and squats gave them the core skills that allowed them to do well. In the same way, let's go to choice E. Where is my choice E over here? If the people who did social interaction did well on mathematics problems, then does it imply that they did do mathematics problems? No, it's just that by doing that social interaction, their ability to do mathematics problems was high. Okay, and this is something which is really important. You've got to visualize that answer choice first independently as to what this answer choice is saying, then in the context of the argument, and then you have to make a decision or a judgment whether it's the correct answer. Okay, really important. So what are the things that we have learned from here? Okay. Were you able to visualize the conclusion? If you weren't able to visualize the conclusion, okay, and if you didn't focus on the usage of the word need to, then essentially you've got to, if you're an EG matter, make sure you understand and go through the master comprehension and inference module, and especially the challenging parts of those modules, to make sure that you understand how to visualize statements and comprehend the meaning. Okay, all of these questions are 700 plus, Ryan. Okay, but that's why you guys are here. You're not here to score 600. If you did not understand the purpose of each statement, if you kind of failed to identify the main conclusion, then learn how to build that logical structure. Learn the role played by each statement. Go through the logical structure and assumption and pre-thinking files over there. If you weren't able to formulate the pre-thinking part, then go to the weakened pre-thinking files. That's really, really important. And maybe spend more time doing pre-thinking. Okay, that's really important. But again, if you visualize, in my experience, if you visualize the information that's given to you in the argument, if you build that logical structure, pre-thinking is fairly simple. Most people have a block because they don't visualize the information that's given to them. Okay. There's a guy who scored a 770. This guy improved his CR ability from 33rd percentile to 97th percentile in about 20 days. And his learning was, and prior to that, when he got to that 33rd percentile, he'd spent about 2 months getting to that 33rd. He says, answer CR questions as if there are no answer choices. Pre-thinking is a game changer. And the whole process of pre-thinking forces you to comprehend the argument. And that's the key to answering any CR questions. Understand the information that's given to you. And pre-thinking is nothing but a litmus test to really say, do you understand the argument? Pre-thinking is not a way to predict the answer. Whatever you pre-think may not be in the answer choices. But the very fact that you can pre-think a good answer proves that you've understood the information there. Sandeep can share the link to the success story. And for those of you who really don't know what their strengths, what their weaknesses are, how much time they need when it comes to essentially taking the GMAT, you know, we can help you build your personalized study plan, figure out whether you are at a 600 or a 620 or a 650 or a 550, which are the areas that you're really strong in, which are the areas that you need help with, how long do you need to spend in SC versus CR versus RC, and why is that? So you guys can book a call there. Okay. With that, I'm going to skip this SC question. I want to do a couple of quant questions as well. So you guys will have this PDF to go through this SC question. Okay. And for those of you who want to know, you know, how do people improve? Our channel has upwards of close to 300 actually journeys on our YouTube channel. Make sure you subscribe to it. We publish 1 to 2 journeys every week, and these are unedited interviews where people talk about how they diagnose their weakness, what struggles did they have while executing their plans, and then what metrics did they track. Okay. Also, I have a webinar this weekend where we go through the process of building a study plan in detail. That's this Saturday at 7:30 p.m. IST. Okay. And lastly, if you're not connected with me on LinkedIn, make sure you're connected with me. Upwards of 20,000 students who are connected with me. If you want to network with people at any top business school, that will allow you to do that. Okay. With that, let's kind of have some fun with quant. Are you guys ready to work on quant? Yes, no. Again, we're going to go through the same process. Our goal will be to make sure that that you follow the process. You focus on drawing inferences from the question stem, understanding constraints, and building certain following certain process skills. So the question that I'm going to serve to you will be juicy questions, which means there will be around the 700 level or so. What it means is that it gives you the opportunity to apply these core skills well. Given the certain question statement, you'd be able to infer information from it. You'll be able to simplify it. In some statements, you'll be able to translate it as well. And there will be statements where you'll have more than one case, and you'd have to be mentally agile to consider all cases and apply constraints, the constraints that are directly given to you or the ones that you would infer from this. Okay, so same process. Don't put in your answers. Say you're ready. I'm going to give you about 2 minutes to solve this question. Here is your first question. Good luck, guys. So 2 minutes. Let me put in my poll question here. All right, thank you, Maneshwar. Let's get a few other folks to be ready, and then we'll move forward. In the last 15 seconds, guys. Three, two, and one. Okay, let's get those answers in. How many people think choice D is the correct answer, which is either statement, each statement alone is sufficient? How many of you think D is the correct answer? How many think C is the correct answer? Both are required. But neither alone is sufficient. And then how many people think A is the correct answer, which is statement one alone is sufficient, but statement two is not. And then lastly, either B or E. Let's get those answers in. Maneshwar says A. Anyone else chose any other answer here? Or was this too challenging or not challenging at all? Amit says D, either one is sufficient alone. What about others? We have A or D so far. Okay, let's move forward. So you're given this expression, and in the question statement, the question is very, very simple. It says, what is the value of X? There's nothing information given to you. And then as you look at statement one and statement two, you have, you know, these reasonably complex expressions. So essentially, since we're not given anything else, we're going to move towards the question stem itself. So we're going to analyze statement one. And as we analyze statement one, what we really see is we see x to the power 4 plus x squared plus 1 is equal to 1 by the same expression. Okay. Just to simplify this, we're going to take the denominator to the left-hand side. And again, I'm going to go step by step. There are, you know, if you're someone who's very comfortable with quant, there's a simpler way to do this as well. But I'm going to do it in what I call as a very methodical way. So as we do this, I get the square of this expression is equal to 1. And that's kind of what we call as simplifying this, because this seems a lot easier to deal with. So then we take a square root. And as we take a square root, we get two conditions. We get x to the power 4 plus x squared plus 1, that's equal to 1. Or in other words, we take x squared common, and we get this expression, x squared into x plus 1 equal to 0. Okay. Or the other thing that would come is that this expression becomes minus 1, and in other words, x squared into x squared plus 1 becomes minus 2y, because we've taken this 1 over here, right? Again, going in a very simplistic manner, when you consider this part over here, you move forward over here, this either says x squared is equal to 0, which means x is equal to 0, or x squared is minus 1, which is not allowed, you know, so because a square of a number in the GMAT world, it can never be negative. In the GMAT world, you do not have complex numbers. That's an engineering constraint. Okay. So that's something that's there. Now, when you think about this, x squared into x squared plus 1, this is something that's not possible as well. Why? Because x squared plus nothing over here can make this minus 2. The product of two positive numbers cannot be negative. So you say there are zero values here. There's one unique value, which is x is equal to 0. That's coming here. So statement one alone is sufficient. Okay. So that's something that how you do it. So my choices that are left are either choice A or choice D. Now let's go to choice B, or statement two over here. Statement two says x cubed plus x squared is equal to 0. You take x squared common, and you get x squared times x plus 1 equal to 0. You get two possibilities here, either x squared is 0 or x squared is minus 1. Okay, or x is minus 1, both of which are possible. There is no unique value. So statement 2 by itself is not sufficient. Okay, so when we do this, we say D is also not there. Only choice A is what suffices. As Maneshwar said, you know, if for those of you who are more equipped in quant, who are comfortable in handling and looking and drawing inferences right from expressions, you can do what Maneshwar said as well. It works for expressions that you're comfortable with. But as expressions scale, the more methodical approach scales much more beautifully. And you'll see as you actually go into difficult IR questions what I call as recursive constraints in there. It's a really fun set of questions overall. So essentially, in this case, I think the key piece over here in all of this is, first of all, if you could not simplify, if you did not take the denominator to the left-hand side, then focus on simplifying. Say, what kind of expressions am I more comfortable with? If you did not consider all cases where, you know, x squared is equal to zero or x is equal to minus one, if you didn't consider both those cases, then make sure you focus on considering all cases. Give yourself that mental note. And then lastly, if you did not apply the constraint that x squared is always the highest value of a square of a number is zero, then essentially make sure you learn those constraints because they are used at multiple places. Okay. And again, if you need help, you know, we have some really good free video lessons in our course. You can definitely do those. Okay, with that, let's kind of go into another question where you have to simplify what's given to you and then apply, consider certain cases. So with that, let's go towards our next question. And Sandeep has shared the link to our free trial as well. So here's our next question. Again, the same 2 minutes. Sandeep, if you could remove my video, that'd be great. All right, last 10 seconds. Make sure you've locked in your answers. 3, 2, and 1. Put those answers in. Let's talk about how many people think choice A is the correct answer? Statement one alone is sufficient. How many people think choice C is the correct answer? I'm going to ask between A and C here, overall. So let's move forward. Okay, so well, the first thing that you really see is, you know, you see this expression, it looks scary. And what the question stem says is you have A to the power N minus B to the power N plus C to the power N. Plus d to the power n. So it's you know, addition expression with one number is negative. And it says if a, b, c, and d are distinct positive integers greater than one, and d is greater than c, c is greater than b, and b is greater than a or so. Okay. So that's something that's given to you. So that's the question that you're asking is this odd? So when you think about this, all you have to figure out is the even odd nature of this expression, of this sum that's given to you over here. So One of the first things you've got to really do is to really simplify this expression and say, what is it that you need to find out overall? Okay. And we know that when you raise a number, you know, when you, you know, 2 to the power 2 is still even, 2 to the power 5 is still even, 3 to the power 3 square is even, 3 cube, 3 square is odd, 3 cube is odd, 3 to the power 4, which is 81, is odd as well. So when you raise a number, a natural number, to a power, it doesn't change the even odd nature. So essentially, what this is really asking is A minus B plus C plus D, is this some odd? That's do we have conclusive evidence that this is going to be odd? That's all that this is asking. And that simplification is very, very important over here. Now, when you look at this and you have a sum of four numbers, there are five possible cases that exist. One is, if all of these numbers are even, then of course the sum is going to be even, right? If three of them are even and one is odd, then the sum is going to be odd. So if you have, or if two are even and two are odd, then it's going to be even. You know, 2 plus 2 is 4, or 2 plus 4 is 6. And then if you add 3 plus 5 to it, that's 8. So even plus even is essentially always even, and two odds always make an even. Similarly, if you have three numbers that are odd and one is even, that sum is always going to be odd. And if you have all odd, then also the sum is going to be even. So I think the question that you have to ask is, what's the even odd nature? Can we figure out the even odd nature of each of these individually? Or can we figure out if one of them is odd, none of them is odd, or two or three of them are odd? If we can really figure that out, then that's something that will give us the answer. With that information, let's kind of do the processing. And statement one says A, B, C, and D are squares of consecutive natural numbers. So natural numbers are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. So essentially, what this means is that A, B, C, D are squares of 3 square, 4 square, 5 square, 6 square, or it could be 7 square, 8 square, or 17 square, 18 square, 19 square, 20 square. But either way, because they're consecutive natural numbers, two of these numbers will always be odd, the other two will always be even. Okay. Why is that? Because power does not change the even odd nature of a number. So that's something that we know is given to us. Okay. So if you know two are odd and two are even, we can with 100% certainty say that, hey, the sum is going to be even, it's not going to be odd, okay, right? So statement one is definitely sufficient, so it's either A or D. Statement two is much easier to break down. You're absolutely right. A to the power 4 when divided by 200 has a quotient 1. What this is saying is that A to the power 4 essentially is odd. Why? Because if you divide something by 200 and it leaves the remainder, it's a quotient one. It doesn't really say, sorry, my bad. The remainder one, we don't know what the remainder is either. So essentially what this is saying is A to the power 4 is not divisible. It's either fully divisible by 200. So A to the power 4 is 200, which we know is not possible. But essentially it's 200 plus something. Okay. It only gives us some information on A. It doesn't give us any information on B, C, or D. Since we don't know the nature of B, C, or D, there are just so many other cases that are possible. Statement 2 by itself is not possible. Yep. Remember, it says A to the power 4 when divided by 200 as a quotient of 1. It's not a remainder. The remainder could be anything. So this means your correct choice is choice A. All right. Again, one of the other things when you think about quant is that you'll see these scary expressions, but you've got to trust the test maker to really have these expressions formulated in such a manner that you can simplify those. Again, as I'm going to go back to IR. IR will have even more scarier looking conditions. Or when you look at MSR, the statements would actually be much more scary than what you see in RC in many cases. But then you have to trust the test maker to make sure that whatever you need as long as you get the gist of what's given to you, you'd be able to answer the questions fairly easily. So why do people falter on this? Either they could not simplify, or they did not consider all cases, or they just really gave up given the complexity of it. Okay. And as Maneshwar said, reading fast is one of the biggest sins you could have on the GMAT. Because again, yes, many people feel that time pressure, but it's not a test of speed. It's a test of attention. As long as you're attentive, you will not, and as long as you follow the right process, you will not fall short on time on the GMAT. Okay. One of the other things that's really important is if you're someone who has some gaps, or if you have a lot of gaps, our quant course is designed to give you just the right content to you. So what it really means is that it has a learning architecture which essentially builds a custom course for you. The entire quant course is divided into about 60 modules. Every module starts with a set of diagnostic quizzes. And these diagnostic quizzes then really tell you which learning activities you need to go through, which ones you can skip. So for people who, for example, do well in the concept diagnostic over here. So if you do well in the concept diagnostic, it probably would cross out this and say, hey, you don't even need to go through the even or not concept or practice quizzes. You can directly start with process skills. If you have multiple concepts, even or not is a fairly simple thing, but let's say primes or LCM GCD has multiple concepts, this diagnostic is granular enough where it can really say, hey, you probably need to go through concept two, concept three, but not through concept one or so. Similarly, on the process skills side of things or GMAT skills, it can really tell you whether you need to go through the process skill files or whether you just can directly go to the GMAT skill files. And essentially, this allows you to focus on learning or spending time only on those areas where you have gaps. Okay. With that, let's go to our third question and the final question for the day. So 2 minutes again, guys. Same thing. When you're ready, type in ready. Sandeep, if you could remove me. It is like 786. 7PQ is something like 786. Absolutely, Maneshwar. All right, 2 minutes are up. Let's get those answers in. Sandeep, if you can put my video back in. How many of you think You know, Salud has said, Charlie has said choice C is the correct answer. How many of you think choice C? You need both statements, but neither is sufficient. How many of you think choice C is the correct answer? All right. There aren't many takers for choice C. What about choice D, where you say each statement alone is sufficient? What about E? Again, guys, put a stake in the ground. No one's judging you here. Okay. Maneshwar says E, neither statement is sufficient, and even they're together are not sufficient. How many of you think it's... So we talked about C, D, and E. Let's talk about either A or B. A says statement one just we alone is sufficient, but statement two isn't. And B says statement two alone is sufficient, but statement one isn't. Okay. So when you see questions like this, you have to really do some sort of a pre-processing in there to simplify them and move forward. So the question says, what's the remainder? So you've got to get the specific remainder, a definitive remainder, when a positive three-digit number so is divided by 8. Okay, so the first thing is you have to get the specific value of remainder. Okay, so that's something which is there. So the way you do this is you say, okay, let me express, and this is something that we explain in the DNR module, divisibility and remainder. When you think about 7PQ, it's 7 times 100 plus 10 times P plus Q as a number. Okay. So a translation is really important. And then you can simplify this. And you say this number is equal to 8 times A plus R. This is your classic remainder equation. Okay. So where remainder, of course, has to be between greater than or equal to 0 or less than 8. Okay. So now let's simplify this further. And Maneshwar, you could continue doing it along with this. You say 696 plus 4, so 700 is 696 plus 4. And then 10p is 8p plus 2p. And then you have q over here. So this is 700. This is this. And q comes from here. Okay. Essentially, what you do in this case is you take 8 common because 696 is divisible. So let's just remove this. This is divisible. This is divisible by 8. So you say 8 times 87, that's 696, plus 8 times P. Okay. Or you could just say, hey, these are entities which don't leave a remainder. And all of this is a set of entities that leave a remainder. Okay. So with that in there, we really just say, hey, there are two cases that exist, or we have to figure out the remainder that you get from 4p, 2p plus 4 plus q. And there are two cases that exist where you can say, hey, if this number is less than 8, then the remainder is simply this value. Okay. If the number is greater than 8, then the remainder would be the remainder of whatever this expression is. Okay. That's just as simple as that. I won't call it simple, but again, if you follow a methodical approach, you know, you even before you look at statement A, you'd be able to get this. Okay. Now with that, you look at statement A. It says 2p plus q is 7. Remember, we had 2p plus q over here. So it gives you the value of 2p plus q. So and we substitute that value over here. So 2p plus q is 7, and the remainder was the remainder of this expression, so which means the remainder of 7 plus 4, which is 11, okay? But again, as I said, this is greater than 8, so we'd subtract 8 from it, and you get the remainder as 3, okay? So definitely, it's a unique value. It's a definitive value, so statement 1 alone is sufficient. So my answer choices could be either A or D at this point, okay? B is gone, C is gone, and E is gone. All right. Let's look at our second statement. Okay. It says P plus 2Q is equal to 11, which means you can really just say that P is equal to 11 minus 2Q. You can substitute P in terms of Q. Remember, our remainder was 2p plus q plus 4, which is what we had gotten out. So, which means let's substitute p in terms of q. So, you said 2 times p means 2 times 11 plus 2 times 2q is 4q. So, 22 minus 4q plus q plus 4. Right? Or if you just simplify this, it'll be 26 minus 3q. Now, depending on the value of q, q could be any number from 0 to 9. This would have different remainders, which means there's no unique value, which means statement 2 is not sufficient. Okay. So the correct answer is choice A. Okay. Again, it's one of the things that you have to really just think about when you think about this question is, how am I approaching it? Did I just jump into thinking 2p plus q and I'm going to kind of figure something out over here from this? Or did you simplify and really say, why is it that the author has given me this question in the form of 7pq? You know, there has to be some way to kind of simplify this and get constraints and express the remainder in terms of p and q right away. Okay. So if you could not translate the information, then learn how to do it. In fact, try similar questions where you could apply this translation, and you're going to find this is a very elegant way to look at remainder questions. Okay. If you did translate it, but you could not manipulate, you could not substitute these values over here to get the remainder or get a unique value, then definitely figure out where you made a mistake, because that's a much simpler skill. And if you did not apply constraints that, hey, the remainder has to be less than the divisor, then again, remember those constraints. I don't believe many people would falter here. This is where most people would falter. Okay. This weekend, we also have a webinar on inequalities and absolute value. One of our subject matter experts, Harsha, would be hosting that webinar. Definitely, if you need help with inequalities, absolute values, if you want to learn how to build, apply those scalable methods, definitely register for that webinar. Okay. And it's these little tweaks that can help you push that score to a 750 or your quant score from a Q47 to a Q49, Q50, or a Q51 or so. Okay. It's not that, you know, a lot of us know the concepts. It's about applying the concepts. It's about building those process skills, starting from simplifying to drawing inferences, to considering all cases, to applying all the constraints that push us towards that 50-51 score or so. Okay. With that, again, if you need help with your study plan, you can always book a call or write to me at rajat@e-gmat.com. With that, let me just stop sharing my screen. And so, questions that you have. Be happy to take on any questions that you have. If you don't have any questions, then I want to thank you for joining me today. It was a pleasure hosting this webinar. Also, let GMAT Club know you know, how you think about this webinar by pressing on the like button or you know, writing to them. Okay. This is pretty much the session. Yes, it's about an hour and a half into the session, Ryan. Our own sessions on the EGMAT platform, which we do using Adobe Connect, they go to about 2.5-3 hours or so. So definitely register for those. We host two sessions every weekend. You'd like those. They're way more interactive because Adobe Connect allows us to be absolutely real time. It allows us to put in 10, 12 poll questions. Or two or three poll questions simultaneously of different kinds. So also you get way more opinions there. So it's fun to really see how different people think about a problem and how they visualize information. Definitely join those sessions on the weekend, the strategy session, as well as the session on inequalities and absolute value that we have this weekend. Okay. With that, thank you very much. And The other piece which is there is, if you haven't subscribed to our YouTube channel, we also publish, you know, interesting tidbits. You know, a couple of weeks back, we published a video on three uses of but, and, you know, but's a very common keyword on the GMAT, but there were some surprising ways in which the GMAT uses but. So we kind of publish those tidbits every now and then. It's just, you know, a fun thing for us, and I think it's the way our SMEs do that, that they make learning fun. So so definitely subscribe to the channel as well. Okay, with that, I want to thank everyone for joining me, and again, if you have questions, doubts, write to me at rajat@edashgmat.com. thank you, and have a great day.